it was the tail end of, I suppose, that sort of life, you know, where people still managed to keep up big houses. But of course, all that changed dramatically with the war. I mean, really, almost overnight it changed. Well, I suppose it was very Victorian. I mean, we were, it was sort of seen and not heard, which was sort of sums it up, really. You know, and when we went down to see our parents in the evening, I mean, we were changed to go downstairs, put on our dresses, frocks. But it was just the way, a Victorian way of doing things. It was really very regimented, one's life as a child. I think there were 36 before the war. I mean, there were, I think, a butler, an under-butler, and I think four footmen, and eight housemaids and a housekeeper, and then various sort of hall boys and things. And then there was a kitchen staff, which was chef and sous chef, and I don't know how many kitchen maids. And then there was a thing called a still room, which was where they made all the sort of cakes and pastries and sweets. And that was in a different part of the basement. Everybody had a feeling that this was the end of an era. That was really the last huge ball that anybody had. Everybody said it was like the ball before Waterloo because it was amazing. I mean, I sat upstairs in the gallery aged 10 just watching the guests arrive, but they were all in their full sort of regalia, tiaras and jewels and white ties, obviously, and all the servants were in old-fashioned livery. White stockings and buckle shoes and wigs and scarlet tunics. I remember looking down and seeing it all. Yes, it's a sight I'll never forget. And the whole of the courtyard was lit up. And I think quite a lot of people arrived in carriages. Nothing was ever going to be the same again. All the staff were called up and for the war. So there was minimal staff. And then there was a huge move of everything out of that side of the house into either the stables where it was stored, or there was a big sale. Of all the furniture out of the big bedrooms upstairs. So it was a dramatic change. I mean, I think they were only given 48 hours to actually clear the house. That's quite something when you think of a house this size. I do remember very well that we had to... when there was an air raid in London, for some unknown reason, the sirens used to go off here, and we all had to go down to the basement. That was a rule. And we all had a sort of list in our bedrooms as to what, when the siren went, that you got up, and you collected your dog, which was in your room, because we all had a dog, and the dog had to have... Well, it had a collar and lead, and it ought to had to have a muzzle, not to put on if the dog went mad, I suppose, when bombs started to fall. I mean, it's all so unbelievable to think of now. So when you got up as a 10-year-old, besides sort of putting on your warm underwear and dressing gowns, etc., you had to collect the dog with the muzzle and the torch and your gas mask. That was vitally important. And then make your way in the pitch dark with your torch down to the basement. And of course, you don't seem to have got down there with all this clobber of dogs and leads and collars and gas masks and everything else. Then the all clear went and off you went back upstairs again. The whole of the Italian garden was planted with beetroot and carrots and cabbages, which was actually very ornate. And yes, we had to pull them all up and bunch them up. And we looked after chickens and rabbits for food. And we used to collect a pig bucket every day from the kitchen, which was sort of potato peeling. And you didn't have corn to give chickens. You had this thing called balancer meal, which was a sort of meal supplied by the Minister of Agriculture, I suppose, which you mix with the potato peelings and the cabbage stalks and things, and you boiled it all up. You fed this to the chickens. On the left-hand side of the big monument, that was all corn and wheat. And my job was to drive the cart and horse out from the yard, which was probably about half a mile away, the farmyard, to collect the stooks, which there was a man pitching them onto the cart with a pitchfork. And then when the cart was full, I'd take the lead horse, the second horse, and put it on the full cart and drive it back to the farm. This was quite a job for an 11 or 12-year-old, which I would be then. Imagine in charge of two horses and a whole stack of corn on the back of health and safety. I mean, would have died if they'd seen a child in charge of two horses and a whole cart full of corn. But anyway, we did it, and I loved doing that part of it because I drove the horses while all my poor cousins were picking up these awful stooks, which were filled with every weed you can imagine. And then on Saturdays, as Saturdays was a half day, we went down and we worked in the communal kitchen in Woodstock, which was a sort of restaurant. It was a rather smart name, restaurant, wasn't really. They produced food for travellers going through Woodstock and the children, the evacuees in Woodstock, and anybody else really who wanted to go there, old people. And that was in the glove factory. And all the food was cooked by the ladies in the village. And it was very good. It was sort of cottage pie and steam pudding. And the price for that, which I will never forget, was 6p when there were 240p in the pound for children and 8p for grown-ups. And lorry drivers could have what's called a double eight, which was 1 and 4p. And that was a huge meal. They had soup and stew and a pudding for 1 and 4p. And we laid the tables and washed up the washing machines or anything on a Saturday. That was our work. I had much more freedom than my sisters probably had before the war. Yes, I mean, everybody mixed together very well, much better, obviously, you know, there wasn't a hierarchy like there was before the war. Well, there was, but much less so. You're born into that situation and you accept it as such, because that's the only thing you know. But as you grow up, you realise that, and especially with the war, that everything's changing. Just sort of gradually, it's all broken down. I mean, it's a much more equal, fairer society now, which must be a good thing.